Good evening. I hope everyone is doing well tonight. I have a couple of different topics that I want to address. So my presentation tonight normally is almost 2 hours, and I'm just going to hit a couple of high points. So I've got to skip from one part of my presentation to another. So forgive me. All right. Well, it's a joy to be with you tonight, and in case I don't get another chance to do it, maybe you weren't here yesterday, if I can be of any help to you, please do email me. My website is justinpeters.org, and I've got some other resources, and if you have a question, just email me. I'll do my best to get back with you. Sometimes it takes me a few days because I get a lot of emails. And I'm on the road quite a bit as well, but I will do my very, very best to get back to you. Okay, tonight primarily we're going to be looking at how does God speak to us? How does He not speak to us? How do we know when it's the voice of God? And how do we know that it's God's voice as opposed to just some random thought that we have in our head? And that's what we'll be spending most of our time on tonight. But I do want to address another issue that is very important. And this really goes to the heart of the Word Faith movement, of the New Apostolic Reformation movement, of the Charismatic movement in general. And that is this: are there modern day apostles? Do we have modern day apostles today? Now, before we answer that question, let's talk about what an apostle is. What is an apostle? The Greek word apostolos literally means sent one who is sent. That's really all it means. But it's not quite that easy because there are two different kinds of apostles. There's two different kinds of apostles. One category is that of the apostles of Christ. And when we talk about the apostles of Christ, we're talking about the office of apostle. And we generally denote that with a capital A, apostle, apostle of Christ. And there were 12 of those. Revelation 21, verse 14, describes the New Jerusalem, which is built upon 12 foundation stones on which are inscribed of the names of the 12 apostles. So there were only 12 apostles of Christ. Now, there is another kind of an apostle, and this is an apostle of the church. And this is just in a very general sense of the term, one who is sent out. In this sense, any evangelist is an apostle. Any missionary is an apostle. In a sense, you and I could be apostles, but we denote that with a lowercase a, not a capital A. Capital A, we use that to denote the office of apostle. Lowercase a, just more of a general sense, just one who is sent out. These are apostles of the church. And we see this kind of distinction with other biblical terms as well. For example, elder. In the Bible, elder could refer simply to an older man, or it could refer to the office of the elder, and the same thing with a deacon. In the New Testament, the word deacon, diakonos, could simply mean a servant, very general sense of the term, or it could refer to the office of the deacon. Okay, so there's a few different terms in the Bible that have this kind of distinction, and so we need to keep this distinction in mind when we're talking about whether or not there are modern-day apostles, capital A, today. So, are there any modern-day apostles? Well, in order to be an apostle, capital A, apostle of Christ, a man, had to be a man, had to meet each of the following three requirements. Number one, that man had to be a first-person eyewitness of the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Had to be a first-person eyewitness of the risen Lord Jesus Christ. And dear friends, there are no more of those guys around today. They have been dead for a long, long time, for at least 1,900 years. And so there are no more first-person eyewitnesses of Jesus Christ. Also, if you wanted to be an apostle, you had to be directly appointed by Christ. Jesus had to appoint you as an apostle. You did not run for office. You did not have a campaign. You did not print up a campaign sign saying, "Vote for me, I want to be your next apostle." You had to be appointed by Jesus Christ himself as an apostle. And also, you had to have the ability to perform the signs and wonders of an apostle. You had to be able to heal the sick, raise the dead. You had to be able to do the signs and wonders of the apostles, spoken of in all of these texts, especially 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And in order to be an apostle, you had to meet all three requirements. Not one of them, not two of them, you had to meet all three. And dear friends, there are no modern day apostles today. There is not a single person alive on the face of the earth today who meets even one of these requirements, much less all three. Not even one, much less all three. And you may be thinking, are you saying that nobody has the ability to heal a sick person today? That's right. That's what I'm saying. That is what I'm saying. Nobody has that inherent ability residing within themselves. Nobody can go up to a sick person today at will and just instantly heal that person. It's not happening. Nobody has that ability today. Nobody does. Now, does God still heal people today? Yes, he does. Yes, he does. I fully affirm that, absolutely. I have seen it myself. It's not a common thing. God doesn't do it every day, but he does do it when it is his sovereign will to do so. But nobody has the inherent power residing within themselves to just be able to go up to sick people at will, lay hands on them, and that person instantly, verifiably, be miraculously healed. Nobody has that ability today. So there are no more apostles today. And if there are no more apostles today, then that's a problem for the new apostolic reformation movement, is it not? Because that's what their whole premise is built upon. There are modern day apostles. Well, no, they're not. All these people like Bill Johnson, Che An, John Arnott, Rick Joyner, no. Their whole theological premise is faulty. There are no more modern day apostles. Period. End of discussion. Okay, now I want us to change directions here a little bit. And what I want us to spend most of our time on is this, divine revelation knowledge, more commonly referred to as God speaking. How does God speak to us today? How can we know when it's the voice of God? Now, divine revelation knowledge was a term that was first coined by Essex W. Kenyon. Essex W. Kenyon, we could call the grandfather of the Word of Faith movement. And Kenyon believed in two types of knowledge. The first of these is sensory knowledge, that which we get through our five senses, sight, sound, taste, smell, touch, our sensory knowledge, five senses. The other is revelation knowledge, and this is supernatural knowledge that comes only from God. Now, the catch to this is that according to Kenyon, these two spheres of knowledge are mutually exclusive. And what that means is that reasoning or logical thought is of no value. And we talked about this Friday night. And these false teachers, these modern day so-called prophets and apostles, they'll say, well, if you really want to hear God, if you want to get to the deep, secret, hidden things of God, if you want to learn how to hear God's voice, you've got to disengage rational thought. Put your brain in neutral. And of course, the Bible tells us to do exactly the opposite of that. We are to study, to show ourselves approved unto God. We are to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, and mind. He gave us a mind for a reason. He wants us to use it. The Bible never tells us to disengage our minds when it comes to the things of God. Absolutely not. But Kenyon is the one that first coined the term. Now, Kenyon was the one that first coined the term, but the idea was not new. to Kenyon. In fact, the idea goes way back to the ancient heresy known as Gnosticism. Gnostics derived their name from the Greek word gnosis, which means knowledge. And the Gnostics also believed in this secret divine revelation knowledge through which one could obtain salvation. But to get this knowledge, you had to disengage your mind. You had to put your brain in neutral, put your brain in park, and then and only then could you kind of open up yourself to get all these, you know, secret divine revelation knowledge and words of knowledge and all this coming from supposedly God. And this Gnosticism divided Christians into the haves and the have-nots. Gnosticism was not inherently Christian, but some of the early Christians kind of adopted some of its tenets. And you see some of the early forms of Gnosticism referred to in the New Testament. But basically the haves and the have-nots. So if you were somebody who got dreams, got visions, or you heard from the Lord and claimed to receive these things, you were a have. And if you didn't, well, you are a have-not. And that distinction is unfortunately alive and well today. People in the charismatic movement would say that if you get dreams and visions and you hear the voice of God, then you are a spiritual person. But if you don't, if you're one of these poor people who all you've got is the Word of God, all you've got is the Bible, well, then you're just out of luck. And you're a have-not. And you're not very spiritual because you don't hear the voice of God. You're a have-not. This is Gnosticism. This divides Christians into classes. This is not biblical. This is anti-biblical. Henry Blackaby, you may have heard of the book and workbook entitled Experiencing God by Henry Blackaby. Henry Blackaby, I think, is the one who has been singularly most responsible for introducing charismatic theology into non-charismatic churches. And Henry Blackaby says, in one point in his book, he says, quote, "If you have trouble hearing the voice of God, you are in trouble at the heart of your Christian experience," end quote. And so, if you have trouble hearing and divining the voice of God, well, something's wrong at the core of your Christian experience. Maybe you're not a Christian at all if you don't hear God's voice. I want to show you a couple of examples of people who claim to hear the voice of God. This is from Benny Hinn. Benny Hinn says this. He says, "I want you all to look at me. I want you all to listen carefully to what I'm going to say. This was put to the test by three theologians who read my book because it's in my book. And it's not a very easy thing to understand, but let's pray that the Holy Ghost will help all of us. Man, I feel, and look at the terms, revelation knowledge already coming on me. I want you to lift your hands. Something new is going to happen here today. Holy Spirit, take over in the name of Jesus." Ladies and gentlemen, are you here to learn? God the Father, ladies and gentlemen, is a person, and he is a triune being by himself, separate from the Son and the Holy Ghost. What did you say? Hear it, hear it. God the Father is a person, God the Son is a person, God the Holy Ghost is a person, but each one of them is a triune being by himself. If I can shock you, and maybe I should, there's nine of them. You say, "Well, I never heard that." Well, you think you're in this church to hear things you've heard for the last 50 years? So, Benny Hinn, under divine revelation knowledge, has taught that there is a nine-member Godhead. That's heresy. That's heresy. So not only is he wrong on it, but he claims that God spoke to him. He didn't claim to receive this from studying anything. No, God spoke to him and told him that there are nine members of the Godhead. Well, that's heresy. He is a false prophet. It's interesting. Have you ever stopped to think about how many false religions have begun by an individual saying, God spoke to me. Let me tell you what he has to say. a lot of false religions. In fact, I would say most of the false religions have begun that very way. Two big ones come to my mind immediately: Mormonism and Islam. Both of these false religions were begun by an individual, Joseph Smith and Muhammad, respectively, who claimed to have been alone with God, or alone by themselves, and all of a sudden this entity appeared to them, this thing appeared to them. And it's interesting that initially both of these men were scared of it, this entity that appeared to them. They were initially scared of it, and they should have stuck with their first impressions. But over some time, they became convinced, no, this really is an angel of God, and they got new revelation from this entity, this angelic being. And now we have two huge false religions that were begun in practically the exact same way. And the adherents of one of these false religions, Islam, many of them like to do fun things such as flying airplanes into buildings and cutting people's heads off. So it's a very dangerous thing to say, God spoke to me. Let me tell you what he has to say. He has spoken to me. He's given me something new. Let me tell you all about it. Very, very, very dangerous. Show you this from Jesse Duplantis. Jesse Duplantis writes in his Voice of the Covenant magazine a few years ago, he said, "The Lord showed me a new way to look at Matthew 17, verse 20. Now, I have this word new highlighted for a reason. Dear friends, if you're reading the Bible and all of a sudden you think you have found a hidden meaning to a particular passage of Scripture that nobody else in the 2,000-year history of the Christian church has ever seen before except you, you're wrong. Okay, I don't mean to be ugly, but if you think you have discovered a hidden meaning that has escaped the attention of every other Christian for the last 2,000 years, you're wrong. You need to take another look at it. But that's what Jesse Duplantis said happened to him. Now, Matthew 17 is when Jesus is talking about having faith the size of a mustard seed. And Jesse says this, "He," meaning God, "showed me that most people preach on the properties of the seed, but the Lord gave me a deeper understanding on this verse when he told me, I put a dimension on the size of the mustard seed, but I did not put a dimension on the size of the mountain." "I didn't understand," said Jesse. "Look," God explained, "I made sure you understood the dimension of the faith was small, like a mustard seed, but I never set a limit on the size of the mountain. Why do you think I didn't set a limit on the size of the mountain, but limited faith to the size of a grain of mustard seed?" "I still didn't have the answer," said Jesse. Here comes God's answer. "Because if you use any more, you'd blow me off of my throne." Dear friends, I would submit to you that the only one who is going to be blown off of his throne is Jesse Duplantis by God. Who does he think he is? Unbelievable. Oh, but God told him this. God told him this, so it must be true, right? Wrong. Wrong. I want to show you another example. Now, this is a little bit more subtle. Jesus Calling. This is a devotional book written by Sarah Young. This is far and away the hottest selling devotional book anywhere in the world. It has sold millions of copies. It is literally light years past any other devotional book out there. It has been translated into many different languages. Jesus Calling by Sarah Young. Now, this is no ordinary devotional book. And I want to show you some excerpts from Sarah Young in the introduction to this book. Sarah Young says this in her introduction. She says, "During the same year, 1992, I began reading God Calling, a devotional book by two anonymous listeners. These women practiced waiting quietly in God's presence, pencils and papers in hand, recording the messages they received from him." Now, God Calling was a book written back in the 1930s, and it was written by two anonymous women. We don't know who they were. best I can tell, probably Roman Catholic mystics, but we don't know for sure. But these two women claimed to learn how to hear the voice of God. And so it's like they tuned in, and when they hit just the right frequency, God started talking to them. And then with pencils in hand, they wrote down what God was saying. So Sarah Young read this, and she was inspired by it, and she wondered if she too could learn to hear the voice of God like these women did. Sarah Young continues in her introduction. She says, "I knew that God communicated with me through the Bible, but I yearned for more. I yearned for more." You see, the Bible just was not enough for Sarah Young. Just wasn't enough for her. You know, as a theologically conservative evangelical Christian, all of us, I would hope, would affirm the inerrancy of Scripture, that God's Word is inerrant without error. And most evangelical Christians would affirm that. But where the battle is being fought today is not so much over inerrancy of Scripture, but over sufficiency of Scripture. Is God's Word sufficient for us? Is it all that we need? And dear friends, we are losing that battle, losing it big time, big time. Sarah Young continues, she says, "I decided to listen to God with pen in hand, writing down whatever I believed he was saying. Houston, we have a problem." So Sarah Young says that just like the women who wrote God Calling, and they tuned in and hit just the right frequency, she too, one day, she says she was up in the mountains somewhere, I think in the French Alps, she was up in the mountains, and one night, real cold, pretty clear night, and she too, she tuned in and she hit just the right frequency, and when she hit just that right frequency, Jesus started talking to her. She learned how to hear the voice of Jesus. Jesus started calling Sarah Young. And notice what she says, with pen in hand, she wrote down what he was saying. Dear friends, if that is happening, do you know what Sarah Young is doing? She's writing Scripture. She's writing Scripture. That's what she's doing. If Jesus is really speaking to her and she is writing down the words that he is saying, she's writing Scripture. Because whatever Jesus says to her should be just as authoritative as anything in this book. Just as authoritative as anything in this book. Whatever Jesus says to her and she writes down, it should be have just as much authority as John 3:16. So we've got an open canon of Scripture again. Sarah Young's writing Scripture for us. And if you have a copy of this book, you might notice that each devotional, 365 of them, one for each day of the year, of course, each devotional is written in the first person for Jesus Christ. I, Jesus, will do these things. I am such and such. Written in the first person for Jesus. Watch this video clip from popular Bible teacher Beth Moore. Watch this from Beth Moore. Whoops, hang on. That's my fault. I don't have the, you can turn your volume down. I don't have it plugged in. Hold on. Okay. All right, now I'm going to try that again. Here we go.
What God began to say to me about 5 years ago, and I'm telling you, it sent me on such a trek with him that my head is still whirling over it. He began to say to me, I'm going to tell you something right now, Beth. And boy, you rock this one down, and you say it as often as I give you utterance to say it. My bride is paralyzed by unbelief. My bride is paralyzed by unbelief.
So God spoke to Beth Moore, and he said to her, now, Beth, you write this one down, and you repeat it as often as I give you utterance to repeat it. My bride is paralyzed by unbelief. Really? Is it? I didn't know that. But apparently it is, must be, because God told her that. So this is new information. I didn't know the bride of Christ was paralyzed by unbelief, but apparently it is. Because God spoke to Beth Moore and he told her to write it down. Well, then that should be just as authoritative as John 3:16, as Romans 10, 9 and 10, any verse in the Bible. So we've got an open canon of Scripture. You see the problem we're having here? And I used to hear this all of the time, and I'm sure many of you still hear it, and maybe some of you right now, you're really starting to disagree with me, and maybe you think you hear the voice of God. Let me challenge you in this. If God is speaking outside of Scripture in a direct, quotable sense, when people say things like, God spoke to me and he said, quote, da-da-da-da-da, then you've entered some very deep waters. Very deep waters. Because whatever God says to you should be just as authoritative as any verse in this book. God cannot speak less authoritatively on one occasion than he does on another. Friends, if God is speaking, God is speaking. God cannot speak in the Bible and really, really, really mean it. But when he speaks to us today outside of the Bible, he still means it, but he doesn't mean it quite as much as he meant it here. How does that work? He just sort of means it? You see the problem we're having? God cannot speak less authoritatively on one occasion than he does on another. And so all these people running around today saying, God spoke to me, let me tell you what he has to say. Well, you better be very certain about that. God does not take adding to his word lightly. Let's look at some of this. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 2, God says, you shall not add to the word which I command you, nor take anything from it. We are not to add to or take away from anything that God has said. God takes this very seriously. Proverbs chapter 30, add not unto his words, lest he rebuke you, and you be found a liar. Do not add to his words. Revelation 22, Jesus speaking, for I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. If any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part of the book of life. Dear friends, we cannot add to nor take away a single word that God has said. God takes this very, very seriously. But people believe that that's what's happening. And I used to hear it all the time. People would come up to me, Justin, God has spoken to me. Let me tell you what he has to say. If you had people come up and say things like that to you, God has spoken to me. Let me tell you what he has to say. Pastor, God has spoken to me, and he's told me to tell you that our church needs to go this direction. Lots of people out there claiming that God speaks to them. Lots of people. In fact, in Bill Johnson's church, I was speaking with Beyond this morning, Bill Johnson's church, they have a, no, excuse me, it was an Emmy, right? Emmy Church, the guy that said that God speaks to him through animals on the television. There's some guy connected with Emmy Church, and he says that God speaks to him. He hears the voice of God through animals watching television. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. In Bill Johnson's church, they get people together, and they get people real quiet, and they listen for the voice of God, and they're supposed to get pictures in their minds of different animals. And whatever animal comes into your mind, that's God speaking. And whatever animal comes into your mind, that's your prophetic word for your neighbor. And some guy was sitting there, and this animal popped into his mind, and it was a salmon. And that was God's word for the fellow sitting next to him. God tells me to tell you that you need to swim upstream. Give me a break. That is stupidity. That's stupid. God doesn't speak like that, and yet that's mainstream in the charismatic movement. New Apostolic Reformation, Word of Faith. That's not uncommon. That is common. I was watching a video this morning from Bethel Church, and a lady there says that they're toddlers get words from the Lord. God, their 3 and 4 year old kids are prophesying. Really? This is common. And people will come up and, you know, you hear all these people say, well, God spoke to me. Yeah, I was doing the dishes this morning and God spoke to me. Or I was out doing this, doing that, God spoke to me. And you hear all these people talking about God speaking to them. And has it ever made you wonder, what's wrong with me? You know, all these people talk about hearing the voice of God. I don't hear God talk to me like that. Is there something wrong with me? Do I not have enough faith? Am I not as spiritual as these people are? They just have a closer walk with God than I guess I've got. You know, I don't hear God speak like that. What's wrong with me? Maybe I'm not even saved. And people start wondering about this. And then we're told that prayer is a two-way street. Have you ever heard this? Prayer is a two-way street, right? So we talk to God, and then we wait to hear God's voice, and we listen for God to talk back to us. I heard this growing up in a Baptist church. I mean, it's not even charismatic. But I would hear this, and I would think, okay. And so you hear these things, and a lot of people try it. You know, everybody else is hearing the voice of God, so there must be something to it. And so prayer is a two-way street, and so this is what we do. And have you been here before? So you hear this, and you're very serious, and I don't mean to make light of anything. You're very serious about it. You want to hear the voice of God. All these other people are hearing it, so you think there's something you're missing, and you must be able to find some way to hear him as well. And so you get by yourself. You know, you turn the television off. The kids are in bed. No distractions. You get into your study or your bedroom or your prayer closet or whatever you want to, however you want to refer to it, and you get really quiet and you go to the Lord in prayer, and you're very sincere, but you go to the Lord in prayer and you talk to the Lord for a while and you say, okay, Lord, I need to hear from you. I've got this coming up in my life. I don't know what to do. Please speak to me. I'm listening. And we get real quiet and we listen real hard. We concentrate. And then, inevitably, what happens? A thought, right? Whew, flashes through our minds. We have this thought. We think, oh, was that you, Lord? Or was that me? How do you know? Used to drive me crazy. Was that you? Was that me? Was that the pizza I ate tonight? How do you know? How do you know when it's the voice of God? Friends, you won't find anything like that modeled in Scripture. Nowhere. When God spoke in Scripture, He was crystal clear, very clear about what He said. There was none of this, was that you, Lord? Can you, if that was you, can you say it again? Was that, you won't find that modeled in Scripture. When God spoke in Scripture, it was very clear. People knew exactly what it was that He said. Even when the Holy Spirit spoke in the New Testament, did He speak through animals? Well, there's one example in Numbers chapter 22, but that's Old Testament. But in the New Testament, do you see God speaking in all these weird kind of different ways? But even when he did speak, people knew exactly what it was that he said. When the Holy Spirit spoke, Acts chapter 13, verse 2, I think, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I've called them." Very specific, very clear, crystal clear. They knew his exact words. There was none of this, "Is that you, Lord?" You won't find that modeled in Scripture. You know, we get this idea that in the Bible days, God was just speaking willy-nilly all the time to everybody. He really wasn't. He really wasn't. God didn't speak nearly as often as a lot of us think that he did. And there was 400 years between the Old and New Testament. God didn't speak at all. He was silent for 400 years. Didn't say a word. But when he did speak, very clear, crystal clear, they knew exactly what it was that he said. So, how can we know the voice of God? Well, let's go to the text, Hebrews chapter 1. God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers and the prophets in many portions, in many ways, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the world. The writer of Hebrews says that in the old days, in the Old Testament, God spoke in a lot of different ways. Indeed, he did. God spoke to Moses up on the mountain through a storm and thunder. God spoke to Elijah through a still small voice, which, by the way, was not some inner impression. It was still an audible voice. Numbers chapter 22, God made a donkey talk. So God did indeed speak in many different portions and in many different ways. But in these last days, says the writer of Hebrews, he has spoken to us in his Son. Friends, Jesus is the final speaking of God. The final speaking of God. Everything that God has to say to us, he has said in his Son, Jesus Christ. And we have a perfect, inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient record of that in his Word. Jesus is the final speaking of God. Now, I don't want you to misunderstand me. Am I saying that God does not speak to us today? No, I'm not saying that at all. God does speak to us today. Right here. This is how God speaks to us. This is how he speaks to us. Oh, well, if you're saying he just speaks in the Bible, well, how do I know where to go to college? How do I know what job to take? How do I know who to marry? How do I know where to live? You're saying God doesn't give direction? No, I'm not saying that at all. God does give direction. God does give wisdom. James says very clearly, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him pray to God. God will give wisdom in agreement with his word. God will give us, you know, you hear people say, well, God laid you on my heart, or God gave me a burden for someone. Can God do that? Sure he can. I don't have a problem with that. You know, of course God could lay somebody on our hearts or give us a burden for somebody. But do we have a mechanism necessarily somewhere in our head to know exactly when it is that it's God doing that? You know, one of my good friends back home is a man named Chad Stewart. I grew up with Chad. I've known Chad since I was a toddler, literally. And from time to time, I'll think about Chad, even though I live 2,000 miles away from him now. But from time to time, I'll think about Chad. And I might say a little prayer for Chad. Is that God bringing Chad to my remembrance? I don't know. Maybe. Maybe I just happen to think about Chad. You know? I mean, the Bible says we're to bear one another's burdens. We're to pray for one another. So, you see what I'm saying? We don't have a mechanism. There's no flashing red light that goes off in our heads to say, oh, this is God, so you better really pay attention to this one. We don't have a mechanism to know when it's God. You know, Does God direct our paths? Yes, he does. Absolutely. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 6, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not unto your own understanding, but in all of your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. It doesn't say he might direct them. It doesn't say he'll direct them if he doesn't have anything better to do. He will direct your paths. How does God direct our paths? I don't have the slightest idea. I just know he does. Dear friends, he spoke the universe into existence. I think he can direct our paths. He just does it. Well, how do I know God's will for my life? You know, as there have been books and Bible studies and all this, how to know God's will for your life, or how to hear the voice of God. You want to know how to know God's will for your life? Can I save you a lot of time and heartache and confusion? Here's how you know God's will for your life. Read, study, and obey his word. Read, study, and obey his word. If you're not doing that, then nothing else matters anyway. I find it very interesting that all these people who claim to hear the voice of God so often, God's always talking to them in a dream, in a vision, or through animals on the television, yet they couldn't tell you the difference between their Bibles and a cookbook. They don't know anything about doctrine and theology. So if you're not reading, studying, and obeying God's word, don't worry about anything else, because nothing else matters anyway. But if you are doing these things, if you are reading God's word, studying it, and applying it, obeying his word, and you have some big decision in your life, you've got something, some avenue, or you've got to make a decision whether to go this way, or choose this thing, or maybe you've got some kind of a ethical dilemma or something like that, pray for wisdom. Seek some godly counsel. The Bible says there's wisdom in a multitude of counsel. Men, go seek some godly men that you know. Go seek the counsel of some men that you know are walking with the Lord. Seek their counsel. Go to them for counsel, for advice. Ladies, go to some godly ladies you know. And if, ladies, if you're married to a godly husband, your husband should be the first person you consult. So go to some godly people. Ask for their wisdom. Ask for their counsel, their advice. And then look at the opportunities that you have before you. Make a wise decision. And then do whatever you want to do. Do whatever you want to do. As long as you're reading, studying, and obeying God's word, you're walking in obedience to the commands of Christ, do whatever you want to do. And trust God that he will direct you and he will honor your obedience. You don't have to worry, oh, well, if I choose this university instead of this university, or take this job as opposed to this job, if I choose the wrong one, then everything in my life is just going to come unraveled and just collapse, you know, like a house of cards or a row of dominoes. It's just going to spin out of control. No, relax. Relax. God spoke the universe into existence, dear ones. He has you in the palm of his hands. He will direct your paths. No problem for God to do that at all. And please don't think that if you are not hearing the voice of God, if you're not hearing these, you know, voices inside your head, that there's something wrong with you. No, I would say there's something wrong with a person who is hearing that stuff. You want to know how to hear God's voice? I'll give you one way that you can absolutely, 100% guaranteed, you will hear God's voice. You will hear God speak to you. You want to hear God speak to you? Read your Bible. If you want to hear God speak to you audibly, read it out loud. I promise you, 100% guaranteed, you will hear him speak. You will hear him speak. I like this quote from Charles Spurgeon. Spurgeon says this, "I have little confidence in those persons who speak of having direct revelations from the Lord. as though he appeared otherwise than by and through the gospel. His word is so full, so perfect, that for God to make any fresh revelation to you or me is quite needless. To do so would be to put a dishonor upon the perfection of that word. Amen and amen. God's word is sufficient. It is perfect. We are thoroughly furnished unto every good work through the word of God. As his Holy Spirit illumines his word to us, there is no more revelation today. People are not getting new information. Revelation is new information that is not recorded in Scripture. That's not happening today. Illumination is. When we read and study and obey God's word, God's Holy Spirit illumines the meaning of what is already written for us. And his word is sufficient. Anything else, we have exceeded what is written. We have gone into the realm of mysticism. We have entered into the realm of the metaphysical cults. Profoundly dangerous. Dear ones, God's word is sufficient. His word is sufficient. We'll close in a word of prayer, and then we'll have a few minutes of Q&A. I think we have some questions. So let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Father, there are so many noises out there, so many confusing voices, so many people claiming to hear you, and yet what they claim to hear from you when they communicate it, it's not in agreement with your word. It leads people astray. It puffs up their own supposed spirituality and sets them above everybody else and makes other people feel inferior. We know these things are not from you. We know that you have preserved your word for us, and it is sufficient. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped, thoroughly furnished for every good work. Not some, every good work. And so we thank you for your sufficient word. May we rely on it and not these things that just deter us from you and seek to get us off the track. So, Lord, may we read, study, and obey your word. And we trust that your Holy Spirit would illumine what is written to us and will apply it to our hearts, to our minds, and we will live lives of obedience to the commands of Christ. And in so doing, we will glorify him. These things we ask and pray in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.